Like Ms. Edwards said, I am a mom, and sometimes I substitute teach here, and I'm also a wife, and a daughter, and a sister, and lots of other roles. But today, I'm going to try to do my very best in speaking about two chapters from your Pilgrim's Progress book, chapter 32 and 33. And we lived here in Rose City for several years, but then God called us away to Oklahoma. Have you guys heard of Oklahoma? It's pretty far away from here, several states out west. And while we were there, my children were very blessed to go to a Christian school there, and they spent a lot of time studying the Pilgrim's Progress book. I think my son Joseph, who's a senior now, I believe he was in the fifth grade, and the teacher went through the whole book, and he did lots of projects like your guys' teachers are doing. Now, they didn't have the movie that I think you guys are going to get to see the movie at the end, and I know my daughter Sarah got to see the movie, so that's really good. But it's such a good book with lots of just good life lessons. And my older daughter, Anna, she didn't get to go through it as a student, but she asked for the adult version, which is by a man named John Bunyan. And so she's been trying to read that and study that and learn as much as she can. Okay, so before we start, I'm going to ask you guys to bow your heads and pray with me. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for this time that we get to spend together and going over the two chapters in the Pilgrim's Progress book. And I just pray, Lord, that you'll open up our hearts and our minds to what you want to say to us and help us to learn these life lessons. And we just out all of this thing, these things in your name. Amen. All right. So we're talking about chapter 32 and 33, which is the Valley of Peace and Bypath Meadow. You guys have read all of that? All right, so a role that I have is a group fitness instructor. So I'm going to ask just the students, the teachers can stay seated. If you'll stand up for me, students, we're going to do a little bit of exercise. So spread out just a little bit. First, I want you to start by doing some just little running in place, little jog in place. Keep going, keep going. All right, now we're going to go a little bit harder. Pushing your arms up and down in the air after doing those jogs in place. Keep going. Keep jogging. Keep pushing. A little bit harder. A little bit harder. All right. Now I want you to drop down. I want you to give me 10 push-ups. 10 push-ups. Keep going. Keep going. Good. All right. Back up. Let's do the jogs in place again. Let's push these arms up and down. Harder. All right, now spread out. Make sure you're careful. Give me some jumping jacks. How about 20 jumping jacks? So, are you guys going to get a little bit in bed? Maybe. Tired now. All right, let's go ahead and drop down. Let's do maybe 10 more push-ups. You guys can have a seat for the rest of it. Okay, so maybe you're feeling a little winded. Maybe not. Maybe you guys are super in super good shape. That's awesome. But maybe you're feeling a little bit winded. So we're picking up. We're Christian and hopeful. They're feeling pretty tired. They're feeling pretty weak. And they're trying to go and make their travels, but they're going pretty slow because they are feeling just weak and their strength is failing and they just want to find a place to rest. I don't know, maybe you guys after a few minutes of me pushing with the exercises, you would have been like, Mrs. Phillips, please, we just need to rest. That's how they were in the story. And they're just going really slowly, trying to find their place to rest. Nighttime comes and they keep going because they just can't find any houses or anywhere to go to. Then all of a sudden, hopeful, he sees that the path ahead that they're following, it starts to get wider. He starts to see a river flowing. Things are starting to look pretty good, okay? And he sees this river flowing in the distance. And so I did ask Jonas if he would come and read this verse to me, please, real quick, to us. So he's going to read out of John, chapter 7.
On the last day, the climax of the festival, Jesus stood and shouted to the crowds, "Anyone who is thirsty may come to me. Anyone who believes in me may come. come to the engine. For the scriptures declare rivers of living water will flow from his heart.
Okay, thank you. All right, so those were Jesus' words. Thank you. And he's saying, anyone who's thirsty can come to him. So God provided this place for them to rest. And it had a really nice river flowing in the distance. It was nice, soft grass, a beautiful meadow with beautiful flowers. This part I really like. It said that there were strong fences all the way around it. So that means that you're going to feel protected, okay? Jesus wants to be that rest for you, all right? And everybody say the word rest. Okay, so rest means that we cease work. We stop moving. You guys stop doing your exercises so that you can catch your breath and just rest and just take a minute, okay? So we cease work. We stop moving. It also can mean to refresh yourself or to get your strength back. All right, if you're feeling weak and you just need to rest and get your strength back, okay? Then over on the right side, I put the word Sabbath. Everybody say the word Sabbath.
Sabbath.
Okay, so Sabbath is a day that we stop and we kind of do our rest. We cease work. It's a religious observance, and it's abstinence from work. That means that we don't do any work on that day. And God talks about that in his word, okay? He gives us commands. And that means he told us to do something. He gives us orders or commands, and he's trying to say, this is what I want you to do. And then he's also going to provide, okay? And so he's not going to say, like, take this day of rest, and then, you know, well, how are we going to get food? How are we going to get anything done? He's going to provide for us, okay? He's going to supply everything that we would need that day. And he didn't need to rest. But he knew that we would. He did know that we would get tired. Okay, so then let's talk about, you guys are fifth and sixth graders. You probably don't like to take a nap. Okay, sometimes I like to take a nap. But you guys probably don't really want to take a nap or get any extra sleep. That's not a fun way to rest. So what can rest look like for fifth and sixth graders? Well, a lot of times we overschedule ourselves. Okay, maybe we're in basketball, and we're also doing cheerleading, and we're also doing Girl Scouts or Boy Scouts, or we're also, going to spend some time with our grandparents, and then we have homework to do. And so we're just over-scheduling and going from one thing to the next without any stopping or any resting. And a lot of times we do all this stuff on the weekend, which is kind of supposed to be our days off of school and our days off of work. And we just keep our weekend so busy, then we get to Monday morning, we come back to school, and guess what? We're super tired. We didn't stop over the weekend to do any rest. So some things that we might be able to do as fifth and sixth graders to help get that rest is go to church. While you're at church, a lot of times you're just sitting, like you guys are sitting here, and the pastor's giving the message, or your teacher, whatever kind of church you're in. And so you can just kind of sit there and rest. Listen to the person talk. You know, yes, you want to make sure that you're listening, and if they have worship time, engage in that, but just also just kind of rest while you're there, just kind of some downtime. Maybe take a break from your electronics, from your cell phones, other games that you might be playing, take a little break from that. Maybe on Sunday, which a lot of that, you know, we would say that's our Sabbath day, maybe do something different on that day that makes it special. And just different about Sunday. Do something special that you don't do on other days. Maybe you could focus a little bit more on your family time and like put your electronics away, have some game nights, something like that. Just be together. And then you also want to make sure that you take this time for yourself, by yourself, okay? And that you're focusing on your personal life with God. You can do a little bit of studying your Bible extra on that day. You can maybe do some journaling or write down some thoughts that you have. Spend some time in prayer and just saying thank you to God. Okay, so it's nothing like you have to go take a nap or you have to sleep extra, but just kind of doing some things different just to kind of slow down. All right, so I want to read one more verse about the Valley of Peace. And remember again, it had the beautiful river in it, the flowers, the meadow. Christian and Hopeful were able to just lie down there and just rest as they needed to. They were protected by the fences. They didn't have to worry about anything coming in to get them. And wouldn't we all want to be able to find a place to rest like that? And so in Matthew chapter 11, these were Jesus' words again. He said, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and who are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." So just remember that when we do feel like we're super tired or we're just overstressed or overscheduled, we can go to Jesus and he's going to provide that safe place where we can rest in him. Okay? All right, so then let's go on to the next chapter, which is called Bypath Meadow. And so the first part, they have just left the Valley of Rest, so they're feeling, you know, pretty rested and everything. And they're back on the path, and then they kind of get off track a little bit. And Christian is thinking to himself, this was all written down in the book, but he didn't think of looking at it just then. And you'll see I found a picture of a Bible that's been covered with dust because it's just sitting there and everybody's looked at it for a long time. And if we would just remember to read the Bible and read God's word. He's given us his word. That's how he talks to us and how he teaches it. And we just need to look at it, open it up. We need to spend some time studying it. And then we need to apply what it says to our lives. And there's so many times that we get ourselves into trouble because we forgot to look at God's word. We just chose not to. That's just not what we thought we needed at the time. But if we would just go back and just spend a few minutes looking at his word, he's going to provide the help that we need. Okay, so they came to the Bypath Meadow, and when they got there, they found out that it belonged to a cruel and powerful giant named Despair. Say the word despair. You guys know what that means. It's like not a good thing. It's kind of like when you're all out of hope and you just feel nothing but despair and sadness. And so this is what this person's name was, where they were. It described where he lived. It said that he was one of the most famous soldiers in the wicked prince's army. He lived in a strong castle, on and on and on. But because Christian had forgotten to look in the word, in the book of life, he would have known all of this if he would have looked, but he forgot. And so he didn't think of looking there. And so as they get there, the path is rough. Their feet start to ache and get tired. And the boys start to get tired even after they've been through all of this rest because of this. Okay? And so we need to be very careful also, because looks may be deceiving. And I found a couple of Bible verses. One is from Proverbs 21:2, and I'll read it to you. It says, "People may be right in their own eyes, but the Lord examines their heart." So we might see somebody who looks really good to us, but maybe they're really not a good person, and God knows their heart. And then another verse, and I found a little picture down here of Samuel, and he was looking for somebody to be the king. And he's looking at David and all of David's brothers. And if you guys know this story, all of the brothers were really big and strong looking, and David was like the youngest, smallest. And 1 Samuel 16:7 says, "The Lord said to Samuel, 'Don't judge by his appearance or height, for I rejected him.' The Lord doesn't see things the way you see them. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." So again, another verse that if we know God's word, he says you don't always have to look at the outside, but look at the inside. And the Lord knows their heart. Okay, and so they come upon this person named Vain Confidence. All right, and this is where we talk about the looks may be deceiving, because this person looked really good. And he was a new character who was walking along in the meadow. And again, here the grass looked really good, felt really good. It was soft and pleasant. And this boy's walking along the fence. He told Christian and Hopeful that this path leads them where they want to go. But again, he didn't have a good heart, and he wasn't telling the truth. And I wanted to give you guys the definitions of these two words. One is vain, and that means that it produces no result. It's basically useless, unsuccessful, ineffectiveness, lacking value. Okay? And then the other word, confidence, if you have confidence in yourself, that's the feeling or belief that you can rely on someone or something, and it's a firm trust. But when you put those two words together, that's not a good meaning. And so I asked the question down here at the bottom of the slide, what other vain things do we put our trust in that end up failing us? Maybe we think, you know, something is really going to work out good for us, and we don't look at the Bible, and we don't spend any time in prayer about it, and then we without that, it just fails us and it doesn't work out for us. All right, we also need to remember, because the boys decided to kind of go along with what Bain Confidence said, and they're going on the wrong path, and we need to remember that our bad choices that we make, because we haven't spent time in prayer, or we haven't looked up things in God's Word for help, our bad choices are going to have consequences. I'm sorry to say that, but I just want to make sure you guys know that. Our bad choices are going to have consequences. Hopeful says, I'm sure we're not in the right way. He starts to realize we're going down the wrong path. And Christian says, how could I have been so foolish? So they both are like, uh-oh, we really messed up. We made a mistake. And I wrote down, have we ever been in similar circumstances where we should have known better, but we made a poor decision, we didn't go to God's Word, and now we realize when we went wrong? Raise your hand if that's ever happened to you. I'm sure it's happened to a lot of people. You think you're doing the right thing, and then all of a sudden you're like, this isn't right, this doesn't feel right. And so we wish we could go back and do it over. So just remember, bad choices are going to have consequences. All right, so then I wanted to talk about something that maybe is going to help you also, along with reading God's Word and staying on the right path, is something called personal accountability. Everybody say the word accountability. Okay, so accountability means it's required or expected to justify actions or decisions, and it's responsible. And so I have a picture of two boys up there, and they're kind of just taking some time to look over God's Word and talking about it with each other. And so accountability means it's an obligation or willingness to accept responsibility for one's actions. So maybe you could find an accountability partner. Have you guys ever heard of that phrase? Maybe you've heard of your parents talking about, I have an accountability partner, and they spend some time with that person, and if they have a problem coming up or a situation where they think they're going to need extra help, they can ask that person to pray for them. They can share some, you know, personal thing with that person. Maybe there's somebody that you can find in your life that can be an accountability partner to you that's going to help you not make those bad choices and not go down the wrong path before it's too late. Okay, so that's something that you can do. And I want to talk just real quick again about that word discernment. That was from a couple slides ago. So everybody say the word discernment. That's kind of a big word. Discernment. Okay, so if you have discernment, that's where you kind of have like this understanding or this feeling like this is a good place to be in, this is a good situation, or no, this isn't good, and I need to just get out of here as fast as I can. So that's something that it kind of comes as you grow older and as you go through experiences, you kind of learn to have more discernment in situations, but that's also something that right now, just like Miss Edwards read the Bible verse about don't let people look down at you when you're young, you can start to pray and ask God to give you discernment, and He will give that to you. If you ask Him for it, He's going to give you that discernment so that you can, you know, start making your way through situations that are hard, and you can become an accountability partner to other students and help them. And so we're just going to finish off by the last slide, which is, I wrote it in really big words, really big letters, is I just pray that you guys are all going to stay on God's path. And that's what we pray for our kids in the book. And so I'm going to ask you guys to bow your heads with me. I want to pray that prayer right now. Thank you, Heavenly Father, again for this time that we got to spend together going over the chapters in the book. And I do pray, Lord, for the students that as they would just come to be able to spend more and more time in your word, that you would give them an understanding and an awareness of what you're trying to teach them. I pray, Lord, that they would be able to find an accountability partner and good, godly friends that are chasing after you, and that they can just follow along and chase after you together. And I pray, Lord, that you're going to give them the gift of discernment and help them to be aware of situations that they should stay far away from, or good situations that they should continue to be a part of. And I just pray, Lord, that the rest of this book will just be such a super blessing to them as they read and study it and do different projects. And I ask all of these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.